Well, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome back to our conference on the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. It's good to have you here. Thank you for coming back this early in the morning. We'll have more folk streaming in, hopefully in the course of the day, and hopefully the rain will stay away so we can fill this auditorium with good folk. A reminder that those of you that have electronic devices, cell phones in particular, if you'd be kind enough to turn those off so we don't have that interrupt the taping of these proceedings, we'd be grateful. One of the hallmarks of the Protestant Reformation is the transformation of law that resulted in the course of the 16th century. Many aspects of public and private life had been governed by medieval canon law, and medieval canon law was predicated on control of the seven sacraments. And one of the early changes introduced by the Protestant Reformation is the abolition of most of the sacraments, a restriction and reduction of those to baptism and Eucharist, undercutting the theological and philosophical foundation of much of the medieval canon law system. And one of the areas of rapid change was in the area of marriage and family law. Marriage had been viewed as a sacrament of the medieval church, and questions of marriage formation, maintenance, dissolution, issues of parental care and control, child custody, and education were all viewed as central to the church's control over that sacramental life of marriage and family. The Reformation, undercutting the idea of marriage as a sacrament, shifting jurisdiction over from the church to the state, and then seeking to scramble to understand the norms and procedures that should govern all the fundamental questions of marriage and family life, from abortion to euthanasia. That was a rapid transformation, a tumultuous transformation in the course of the 16th century, but generally within a decade of the acceptance of a Reformation, local polities had in place new marriage and family laws on the books. That's a story that we know pretty well in the Anglophone literature for the German side of things and a bit of the Calvinist side of things too. What we don't know is what happened in Nordic lands, in Scandinavia. And we have, opening that world to us today, one of the great legal historians in the next generation, Professor Mia Korpiola, a great expert on issues of marriage and family law, on the development of aspects of procedural and penal law, of property and inheritance, and it's that toolbox of expertise that she will open to us as we explore some of the changes in Swedish and broader Nordic family law in the course of the Reformation era. Professor Korpiola is professor of legal history at the University of Turku in Finland and a leading scholar of family law in medieval and Reformation Scandinavia. She has served in the Academy of Finland, the Helsinki Collegium for Advanced Studies, and the Center for Advanced Studies at Oslo. She has published a number of leading works in the field in different languages, but her most important books for this story are provocatively titled Between Betrothal and Bedding, Marriage Formation in Sweden, 1200 to 1600, available on every bookshelf around the world. Regional Variations in Matrimonial Law and Custom in Europe from 1150 to 1600 is not quite the same bestseller, and Authorities in the Middle Ages perhaps even less so. But all these books are marked with great erudition, a extraordinary command of the sources, and a verve in explaining what is at stake in this transformation of marriage and family life. And it's that world that Professor Korpiola will open to us today. May I ask you to join me in applause to welcome Mia Korpiola.
Thank you. It is for me a great honor and a great pleasure to be here today. And thank you also, Professor Witte, for a very generous and kind introduction. So a couple of days ago, I was told, oh no, one PowerPoint again. I hope you will have some pleasure to look at the images, because I think that to understand the period we're talking about, the images from that period important also as a source, and also to understand the mentality of the time. In Martin Luther's Table Talks, he observed, based on his personal experiences, There's no more lovely, friendly, and charming relationship, communion, or company than a good marriage. But for Luther, marriage was no longer a sacrament, but a social estate. That is why marriage and the family became the main building blocks of the new Protestant ordered societies. The Hausvater, family patriarch, having its equivalence in the Gottesvater, the divine father, and the Landesvater, the secular paternal ruler. In this lecture, I will investigate various aspects of the Swedish Reformed family law. I will start by presenting you the background of the Swedish Reformation before moving on to consider the confusion of the first post-Reformation decades. I will then discuss how the Swedish Church Ordinance of 1571 regulated marriage matters and to what extent it reflects continuity on the one hand and change on the other. Before my conclusion, I will, by the means of a small case study, analyze how the Swedish Church Court dealt with difficult cases unregulated by Swedish Lutheran marriage law. However, I would like to stress that not all aspects of family law were influenced by the Reformation. For example, it caused no changes in matrimonial property law, and it had only limited influence on the law of succession, both regulated by Swedish medieval secular law. Swedish law had been compiled and codified in two nationwide laws, one for the countryside and another for the towns, in the mid-14th century. This was relatively early in a comparative European perspective. These two secular laws, in their updated versions, remained in use until 1736. Source material has survived from the late 16th and early 17th century than from the 15th or the first half of the 16th century. In addition, the first continuous series of Swedish church court records date from the 1590s. This means that our knowledge of late medieval customs and the practices of the first Reformation decades is hazier than that of the later 16th century and beyond. Yet, some trends are obviously already visible in the late Middle Ages, such as the growing severity of punishments and the sliding of severe sexual crime from ecclesiastical to secular jurisdiction. Also, the ordering of marriage formation that had been regulated by secular law had already been started by the Catholic Church, even if the Lutheran Church took up the torch with efficiency. Another methodological caveat is related to the explanatory force of the power of the Reformation, i.e. Lutheran faith and religion as a conditio sine qua non, a necessary condition for the changes in family law in Reformation Sweden. Some changes could have taken place in Sweden regardless of any religious revolution that spread to Finland and Sweden from Germany. The changes were not necessarily initiated by the new Lutheran Church, even if they were facilitated by it. An example of this is the growing influence of Roman law on family law. The reception of Roman law was progressing in Germany in the late Middle Ages and 16th century. The growing use of Roman law arguments for extending the possibility of parents to disinherit their wayward children in early modern Sweden coincided with the Reformation. Its emphasis on the Ten Commandments also supported the growing power of parents over their children. That dutiful behavior or disobedience were used as arguments for giving relatives property or disinheriting them was part of these joint trends in Reformation Sweden. Just because the trends were simultaneous, it does not necessarily follow that one directly caused the other. When the Lutheran heresy, as it was called, spread into Sweden in the 1520s, one could not have foreseen that Sweden would become the first kingdom to officially embrace the new creed, and the first territory outside the Holy Roman Empire to become de facto Lutheran in its entirety. How was this rapid official initiation of Lutheranism possible in Sweden? Well, there are two well-known reasons for it. The background was political. The union of the three Scandinavian kingdoms, Sweden, Norway, and Denmark, the so-called Kalmar Union, with its Danish king as ruler, was dissolved in the 1520s. Sweden had seen power struggles and war between the pro-Danish and anti-Danish parties already for decades. The archbishops of Uppsala had sided with the pro-Danish alliance. When the Union King Christian II came to Sweden to be crowned in 1520, the festivities turned into a pre-arranged purge of political opponents, and about 80 people, including two bishops, were executed at the so-called bloodbath of Stockholm. You can see the image there. The archbishop headed the commission, sentencing many of the accused of manifest heresy. The events of Stockholm and the following other executions of political opponents in the country made oppositional powers to revolt. The following year, in 1521, Gustav Eriksson of the aristocratic Vasa family, whose father and brother-in-law had been among the magnates beheaded in Stockholm, was elected as the protector of Sweden. In 2 years, King Christian II was deposed in Denmark and Gustav Vasa was elected King of Sweden. Because of the events, King Gustav's relations with Rome were at a standstill since the start. The new tenets, based on the separation of spiritual and secular power, princely supremacy over the church, and a return to the Bible, obviously appealed to the new Swedish king. However, it is believed that the main reasons behind Gustav Vasa initiated the official Reformation in 1527 at the Diet of Västerås were economic. He needed funds quickly, and these could only be got from the church. Consequently, the so-called recess of Västerås not only insisted that God's word was to be purely preached, but also that the king was granted the power to administer what was called the superfluous incomes of the church in the best interests of the commonweal. In an accompanying ordinance of Västerås, the ecclesiastical jurisdiction was largely, if not completely, explained to pertain to the secular authorities. Well, why is all this relevant for this presentation? I think these facts have explanatory value for several matters that are crucial for our topic. Firstly, as the Swedish Reformation was no movement from below, and its grounds were mostly fiscal and economic, the doctrine of the new church was not clearly determined for many decades. The Diet of Västerås in 1544 proclaimed the evangelical faith, but only in 1593 did the Swedish clergy unite behind the Confessio Augustana and officially define its religion. Secondly, it took more than four decades before the first Swedish church ordinance of 1571 was officially accepted. Moreover, its regulations on marriage and family issues were very patchy and had in many aspects remained unregulated by the new evangelical norms. Thirdly, legal learning had peaked in Sweden in the pre-Reformation decades, but it came to plummet after the Reformation. No high-ranking Swedish cleric is known to have taken a degree in law after the Reformation. In connection to this, and in accordance with Protestant principles, the Bible became the supreme source to follow. Both canon and secular law almost disappeared as a source in the writings of the Swedish clerics, for example, the first Lutheran Archbishop Laurentius Petri. Moreover, the legal procedure of the Lutheran ecclesiastical courts was not defined. Fourthly, initiated from above, the Swedish Reformation has been described as a moderate or conservative one. Although some aspects of the Reformation, such as clerical marriage and divorce, were quickly enforced, Others, such as the impediments of consanguinity and affinity, remained largely unaffected by the Reformation. Marriage formation became closer to the secular practices, abandoning the fine-tuned distinctions of the words of consent in medieval canon law. The jurisdiction of the church and ecclesiastical courts was left vaguely defined and to be curtailed at the will of the ruler. However, no new marriage or disciplinary courts, Ehegerichte and Sittengerichte in some of the German territories, were established like in some places on the continent, nor were laymen included in the ecclesiastical courts. The bishops and their chapters continued to adjudicate matrimonial causes and determine the legitimacy of children. This again demonstrates the Reformation from above and the ensuing continuity of the Swedish ecclesiastical court system. Sixthly and lastly, as the Bible was translated into the vernacular, the emphasis on the biblical Ten Commandments in lay teaching grew. The church was to preach and teach the laity to respect and obey the authorities, including paternal authority. This was relevant for the strengthening role of parents and guardians during the 16th and 17th centuries. Obeying one's parents and fulfilling one's family duty, and thereby deserving one's inheritance rights, became a topic more frequently visible in legal practice. And now I move on to the law of marriage during the first Reformation decades. After the onset of the Reformation, some confusion reigned. Were priests really allowed to marry or not? Did their children have inheritance rights? What practical relevance did it have that marriage now had lost its sacramental status? What exactly did it mean that the Bible was thereafter the guideline of matrimonial law? It did not discuss marriage much, and some of its matrimonial norms were completely unacceptable, such as the levirate or polygamy. These two could be explained away by referring to God's special permission to the Jews that no longer applied to Christians. But what then did apply? If matrimony was no longer a sacrament, divorce would be permitted, like in the Bible, but on what grounds? Adultery only? What about marriage formation, on which the Bible was largely silent? Even if the Swedish reformer Olaus Petri had written several polemic works dealing with some of these issues, there were very few norms determining the new doctrine, converting ideology into practice. The sources are very scanty from this period. As to clerical marriage, Olaus Petri publicly married in 1525. His marriage caused a scandal, as had been intended. Clerical marriage was officially accepted a decade later in 1536, and in 1541, priests' wives were spoken of in a matter-of-fact way. Married clerics and their families were to be models of piety and decorum and set a good example in their parishes. Priests, having lost their benefit of clergy, their special privilegium fori, they not only risked suspension and permanent defrocking for their sexual misdemeanors and crimes, but also the whole range of secular punishment, including decapitation. After 1536, the matter of the inheritance rights of priests' children had been theoretically settled. They were to inherit just like any other legitimate children. The king and the council of the realm resolved a couple of inheritance disputes in the early 1540s, confirming this. However, due to the confusion in the early years of the Swedish Reformation, some of the early clerical marriages had been very discreet. This applied, for example, to the marriages of two canons of Turku, who had studied in Germany, Jakob Venne and Peder Särkilahti. Both had married their concubines in the presence of a very small circle in Turku, and both were dead by 1532, leaving wives and children. Their marriage had been discreet and of short duration. The rights of their children to inherit after their fathers came to be disputed by more distant relatives, and the ensuing lawsuits were only definitely resolved in the late 1560s and 1570, many decades after the official abolition of clerical celibacy and more than 30 years after the death of their fathers. As for divorce, the haphazard documents from the 1530s and 1540s give the impression that the king granted the first divorces based on proven adultery in the late 1530s, and an ecclesiastical statute from 1541, the Articuli Ordinantiae, confirmed that divorce was granted based on sexual infidelity. However, the procedure was not defined. It seems to have become customary that when the ecclesiastical court was presented with a verdict of adultery issued by the secular court, it granted the divorce unless there were special circumstances against it and if there was any chance of a reconciliation between the spouses. Divorce based on adultery was permitted in the Bible, making it a clear-cut case. However, in 1540, King Gustav Vasa divorced a man from his wife who had a mental disease and who had been separated and their property divided for some time already. Here, the children and the wife's friends supported the petition. I have found no early cases based on malicious abandonment, although it came to be equated with adultery in accordance with the Bible in the same fashion as in German Protestant practice. It is obvious that it was unclear in Sweden where the limits of evangelical freedom were and what adherence to God's pure and unblemished words meant in divorce cases. People may have been genuinely confused about the new practice, and some may have been anxious to profit from the unregulated state of affairs, wishing to free themselves of their spouses. Some couples seem to have divorced themselves amicably in a do-it-yourself fashion after desertion and bigamous remarriage. In 1545, a Finnish priest was fined a substantial sum for having divorced two couples without prior consultation with or authorization by the bishop and chapter of Turku. Obviously, the lack of clear norms left space for individual action, even if this was hardly the desired outcome. After refuting Catholic marriage law and many centuries of court practice, the new Swedish church was slow in replacing it with concrete norms, thereby effectively reordering marriage. There had been several attempts to have a church ordinance accepted in Sweden. Archbishop Laurentius Petri had prepared drafts for King Gustav Vasa and King Erik XIV, but neither version had been accepted. Finally, in 1571, during King John III's reign, this was crowned with success. However, the Church Ordinance of 1571 was hardly an all-encompassing summary of reformed matrimonial law, and therefore it left many things unregulated. The Church Ordinance defined marriage in a very Lutheran way, referring to and citing the Bible on various issues. Matrimony was described as an honorable estate, pleasing to and instituted by God. It also emphasized the sixth commandment, "Thou shalt not commit adultery." Matrimony was constituted as a remedy for sin, and therefore sharing bed and board, as well as being of one flesh and blood, was important. Pastors were to admonish couples to remain together for better and for worse, and not, as the text said, easily run away from each other and separate themselves, unquote. This, the ordinance claimed, too often happened to the great peril of souls. This caused scandals and offended God. Following Martin Luther, secret engagements were not to be considered valid, and no maid was to get engaged without the knowledge of their parents or legal guardian unless these gave their consent post fact. As can be expected, the fourth commandment, honoring one's father and one's mother, were referred to here. The church ordinance assumed that consent was to be given if the couple had already had sexual intercourse. However, parents were not allowed to use violence or compulsion in having their children consent to marriage partners of parental choice. If either party did not clearly utter their consent or out and out refused to consent, priests were not to join the couple in marriage. As for marriage impediments, the church ordinance mentioned only few. The impediments of consanguinity and affinity, nonage and crime. Impotence was actually discussed under divorce, but treated like the impediment it traditionally was in the Catholic canonical tradition. Consanguinity and affinity were upheld as impediments to the fifth degree. Spiritual affinity, i.e. the impediment created mainly by baptism, was abolished by being non-biblical, except for cases that created scandal. Even if dispensations on the impediments of consanguinity and affinity could be granted for special cases, this did not apply to biblical prohibitions. However, their exact scope was not specified and would become a fiercely disputed matter precisely at the time when the church ordinance was being accepted. Namely, an aristocratic couple related to each other in the second degree of consanguinity, they were first cousins, asked for such a dispensation, but the archbishop and convoked clergy refused. A huge scandal followed when the couple eloped 2 years later. The impediment of crime, that is, marriage with a person with whom one had had previously an adulterous relationship, was theoretically maintained, but in a simplified form. Moreover, the prohibition was not absolute. Rather, permission for this was not to be easily granted because of the outrage and scandal such unions caused. The text presupposed the husband to be the adulterer, wanting later to marry his former mistress. Priests were also forbidden to solemnize the marriage of children and minors because child marriages were against honesty and Christian discipline, and they were a source of disorder. The clergy was supposed to control marriage formation in different ways. The banns were to be read thrice before any betrothal was to take place. Priests were forbidden to solemnize the marriages of foreign or unknown persons unless they had proof of their single status and that they were unimpeded to marry each other. They were supposed to advise people to deliberate carefully before contracting marriage instead of getting troth-plighted hastily at beer drinkings. Priests were also to promote parity of marriage partners, and you can see there a very typical Reformation satire about mismatched marriages. If the couple asking to be married appeared unequal or mismatched as to their age or other aspects, the priest was to ask them to thoroughly reconsider the matter. Troth plight was considered valid if made in the presence of witnesses and with what the statute called the lawful gifts, usually also with necessary parental consent. If followed by intercourse, a valid marriage had been created. This followed the canonical doctrine of presumptive marriage. However, the fact that a valid marriage promise had to be accompanied by witnesses and gifts represented a significant break with the medieval Catholic marriage doctrine, which had not required any formalities at all. In addition, no mention was made to the words of consent, whether in the future or present tense, that had occupied the pivotal role of medieval marriage formation. This was a major change, probably related to two facts. Swedish medieval marriage formation was perceived as a process consisting of several public legal acts involving exchanges of gifts regulated by secular law. Focusing on words was too sophisticated and caused confusion in a pragmatic and lay-dominated legal culture like Sweden, as leading Swedish clerics had maintained already in the early 15th century. As a means of avoiding the confusion arising when peasants themselves were in charge of troth plights and betrothals, and peasants formed 95% of the Swedish population at the time, priests were to oversee such betrothals themselves and preside over them, with a preceding reading of the banns. Moreover, it was recommended that the betrothal only take place at the church door or in the sacristy. This would have signified the compressing of the betrothal and wedding into one ceremony. However, the church ordinance was aware of the realities of existing Swedish marriage customs by accepting that if the couple had already been betrothed, they were not to be re-betrothed by the priest. Solemnizations of weddings were not to take place during the major ecclesiastical feasts for keeping order in the churches, but the forbidden marriage times were in practice somewhat curtailed from the Catholic ones. Weddings seem in general to have taken place on Sundays. The church ordinance also gave the formulas priests were to use when betrothing and blessing the marriage, and the rituals depended on whether the woman had been previously married or not, and whether she was of childbearing age or not. Marriage formation was to be controlled by the clergy, solemnized with reverence and without excessive drinking and revelry. Hen parties that were customary in Sweden during the evening preceding the wedding were very much frowned upon by the Lutheran Church because of the disorder they caused. The church ordinance ordered clerics to preach against such bad customs that caused people to party all night and come drunk to the church on Sunday. Betrothed or troth-plighted couples were also strictly forbidden to have sexual relations between the wedding, but this seems to have been quite common in practice. According to the ordinance, no ceremonies, for example, the blessing of the bridal bed, you can see that on the picture, in connection to the bedding of the couple at the wedding house were necessary, especially if the priest observed that the wedding guests were simply much too drunk to listen to him. Obviously, this took place in practice. Adultery and malicious desertion were accepted as the only two grounds for divorce authorized by God, while illness such as leprosy was specifically mentioned as not constituting a valid reason for divorce. However, in divorce practice, illness and permanent inability to fulfill one's marital duties, even leprosy, came to be used in individual cases. Here, pastoral considerations such as marriage as a remedy for sin were probably taken into consideration. For divorce causes, the procedure was stated, even if the practice could be quite pragmatic in presumption of death cases. It can also be mentioned here in passing that after the Reformation, the Swedish Lutheran Church started to see every childbirth as a means of disciplining and controlling the parents. This was only alluded to in the church ordinance. As baptism and the churching of women after childbirth were important church ceremonies, priests were expected to inquire into the child's parents. Especially paternity was important and gave an opportunity to investigate the matrimonial status of the parents. Laxity or suspected venality in the officiating priest caused him to be punished for negligence. Late 16th and early 17th century diocesan statutes increasingly differentiated between the rituals for honest matrons and loose sluts in various details to underline the mother's morality or immorality. And then to my case study. But how would the Swedish Lutheran Church deal with difficult cases that were not mentioned in the church ordinance? In order to elucidate this, I will discuss an exceptional and scandalous case from the 1590s involving a noble couple, Nils Takke and Kerstin Eriksdotter Oxenstierna. The case is unique for many reasons, not only the legal issue. Cases involving the nobility are very rare in the Swedish church court records. The aristocracy was generally unwilling to wash their dirty linen in public, and there are unusually many other sources that help to tell the story. The husband, Nils Takke, belonging to the lesser nobility, came to the ecclesiastical court claiming that he had discovered on his wedding night that his aristocratic young bride, Kerstin Oxenstierna, was no longer a virgin. During the proceedings, it transpired that the teenage Kerstin had been deflowered by the German tutor of her younger brothers, Zacharias Regius, possibly the grandson of the famous German reformer Urbanus Regius. To make a long story short, the couple had been so besotted with each other that they consummated their love in a carriage on a ship in a sheltered harbour in the Åland archipelago. The Oxenstierna family, I haven't seen the Titanic myself, but I've heard that this scenario is a bit like in the film. The Oxenstierna family was returning from Sweden to Sweden from Tallinn. You can see it on the picture, where Kerstin's father, Baron Erik Gabrielsson Oxenstierna, had been governor when Kerstin's mother, Benedicta Gera, went into labor. When she was having birth to yet another Oxenstierna baby, the couple sneaked away to have some privacy while the attention of everyone else was focused on the parturition. Kerstin's parents had later discovered the affair and beaten her, but both had died shortly after. This was between the match between Kerstin and Nils had been made. I could go on and entertain you with endless details about the case, but as time is flying, I will only stick to the lawsuit. The legal case boils down to this. Could Nils Takke get a divorce or an annulment from his wife? Archbishop Abraham Angermannus and the Stockholm Consistory heard the details of the case. Had Nils Takke any reason to suppose that his wife had been unfaithful to him after their marriage? He may have had made some vague allegations, but he admitted he could not accuse her of any impurity after their betrothal or marriage. Thus, Kerstin had not committed adultery, for which the 1571 church ordinance would have authorized divorce. Moreover, the court had not discovered any important reason for divorcing them. Because the church ordinance was so brief, it provided absolutely no guidelines for the question of annulment because of an impediment in the case. In addition to the impediments already discussed, it only stated whenever matrimony is contracted illicitly and unlawfully, it is reckoned as null and void. Yet such cases had certainly been discussed by medieval canonists and resolved by the Pope. Namely, in learned marriage law, this was a classical case of error. The point was that no sacramental and indissoluble marriage had been created if there was an error in the consent of one of the parties. Medieval canonists had classified the impediments of error into four subcategories. A person could mistake the identity or the person of the spouse, like in that image there, in the Old Testament, when Jacob wanted to marry Rachel but was duped by Laban into marrying her elder sister Leah instead. A person could have mistaken the other's condition, believing his or her intended to be free, while in reality he or she was a slave or serf. Someone could make a mistake about his or her future spouse's wealth or dowry, intending to marry a rich person, but in reality wedded a pauper. Finally, a person could have been misinformed or misjudged of his or her spouse's personal qualities, such as health, beauty, wisdom, fertility, honesty, or chastity. Not all types of error annulled a marriage, but in certain cases, the lack of an initial consent was remedied retroactively if the innocent and ignorant party re-ratified the union after discovering the truth about the erroneous facts. This could either be made explicitly by new words of consent or tacitly by continuing to cohabit and have subsequent sexual relations with the spouse. Medieval canonists had dismissed the possibility of annulment based on an error on the spouse's personal qualities because of the obvious biblical example, the marriage of Virgin Mary. Joseph had believed that he was marrying a virgin bride, only to discover that she was already pregnant and carrying someone else's child. However, 15th century popes had started to annul unconsummated marriages in which a man had been duped into marrying a pretended maiden who was already carrying another man's child. But Chadstin had not been carrying another man's child, so it would have been a difficult case even in canon law. But how about Protestant theologians then? Luther's opinion was to allow the innocent spouse to contract again with another because of the deceit, if the fault was both serious and enduring, if he or she had really been ignorant, and if knowing the truth, the innocent spouse would not have consented to the marriage. However, Philip Melanchthon was against annulment in the case, and generally speaking, the opinions of the Protestant theologians and lawyers were divided. Yet the growing trend was to accept the annulment of marriages in which the bride had been deflowered by another. Archbishop Abraham Angermanus did not cite any authorities to back out his reasoning in the case. However, the case was finally solved based on the duped husband's behavior after he had discovered the truth of his bride on their wedding night. He had not left her immediately, complained to the relatives, and launched an annulment cause. Instead, Niels had continued to stay with Chastin for a while, consummating the marriage and even getting her pregnant. The court found that Niels had forgiven Chastin, re-ratified their union, and restored her honor. What God had united, the court said, no man could put asunder, and the validity of the marriage was confirmed. What does this case teach us about dealing with difficult marriage causes in Reformation Sweden? When Swedish ecclesiastical or secular law did not provide a solution to a legal problem, the medieval canon law tradition, probably mostly through Protestant German theologians as intermediaries, influenced by the ongoing reception of Roman law in the late medieval and Reformation Germany, was used. And I now come to my conclusion. The Swedish reformers saw themselves as cleansing family law from the errors of the papacy by a return to the Bible. They also aimed at reordering marriage so that the new clerical model families were to teach, with words and their own example, the essence of Lutheran family life. Order, well-being, and happiness were the outcomes of harmonious families. However, considering the aims, a delay of many decades before the first comprehensive church ordinance was accepted did not assist in reaching this goal by establishing rules and norms. A general confusion followed, and it was only cleared piecemeal through legal practice and shorter statutes, permitting clerical marriage and ensuring the inheritance rights of their children, opening the doors to divorce and confirming the traditional ecclesiastical court structure, so both changes and continuities. The 1571 Church Ordinance, with its two chapters on marriage, rectified the situation only partly and Reformed marriage law remained under-regulated in Sweden. The Swedish divorce norms were rather careful and biblical, but the practice was somewhat more liberal, giving room for pragmatism and pastoral considerations. As for marriage formation, it strongly emphasized control and restraint. This followed the tradition already established by the Catholic Church, but with more efficiency. Also, mothers of babies were especially targeted as objects of control through baptism and churching, as distinctions between virtue and vice had to be made. The avoidance of outrage and scandal was mentioned repeatedly. Apparently, the Swedes, predominantly peasants, were perceived as ignorant and unruly people whose customs were unsuitable for Christian restraint and whose lustfulness and heavy drinking were constant threats for proper order and discipline. However, they were to be taught and educated to become more well-ordered and pious. Thus, Lutheran Swedish family law was not built on the smoking ruins of the Catholic canon law, but rather the reformers only demolished some unbiblical parts to make the structure correspond better to their perceptions of the will of God. The legacy of the Catholic Church was not often mentioned, but the influence may have mainly been transmitted through German Protestant theology. The Lutheran Church then continued to build on the same structure to construct a God-fearing and well-ordered home for all Swedes, not based on works, but ultimately rather on Christian grace and love. Thank you.
Wonderfully done. Thank you so much for this brilliant tour of an important chapter in the history of marriage and family and sexuality norms that we don't know much about in the Anglophone world. Between Betrothal and Bedding is a bestseller in Scandinavia, and I hope that it'll become a bestseller here. You can hear from the presentation there's nothing new under the sun. Sex, lust, drinking, carrying on. A wonderful thing to start our conference on its second day. The floor is open for a couple of questions to Professor Korpiola. May I ask you again to use the mics, and if we can bring a mic to you, we'd be delighted to do so. Sir.
Dr. Korpiola, in America, particularly in conservative churches, there is long been a restriction on divorce and remarriage among ministers. Now, in the early Reformation Sweden here, now that ministers can marry and have children, were the same divorce regulations applied to them as to lay people?
Thank you for the question. Yes, basically the same rules applied to the clergy as well. And in case of adultery, and there were clerics who were adulterers in those times, just like today, they were actually sometimes divorced by their wives. And sometimes in really scandalous cases involving perjury, for example, actually also executed for their crimes. In that case, the executioner took care of the divorcing.
Yes. Could you say a bit more about the pastoral concerns of those who were seeking divorce?
Thank you. Yes. For example, in couples where either spouse, usually the wife, had been ailing for years and years, for example, bedridden, not being able to take care of the household, not being able to fulfill her sexual duties towards the husband, and the husband was young enough so that there was concern that he would lapse into sexual sin. In that case, for example, divorce in case of illness was granted. So I would this, for example, was an example of this kind of pastoral care and concern. And that's why also the parity, they were discouraging couples with a big age gap, because they feared that when one spouse was considerably older than the other, the younger one would at some point lapse into sexual sin.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm curious as to how you feel the Reformation in Sweden affected views of cohabitation, for example, into today.
Thank you. Well, the Swedish marriage process was a thing constituted of many legal acts, and sometimes couples were caught in the middle, so that they never went through. So after they have got engaged, they started to cohabit, and they never went into church to solemnize their marriage, which of course the church wanted them to do. So sometimes the church ferreted out these kind of couples in the middle of the marriage process, but not actually yet solemnizing their union, and tried to push them into solemnizing. So you can see that there were different kinds of unions there, and sometimes out-and-out cohabitation and concubinage, so that you can really find all types of living arrangements in those times also. But of course, they were against the doctrine of the church, and the church tried to have everyone go through the whole marriage process under the control of the church and solemnize their union.
Final question? Professor McDaniel, final question.
Interesting presentation, wonderful.
Thank you.
I want to ask a slightly different question. In your very early presentation, you talked about the difference in which the ways of dealing with possession and properties were addressed differently. Sociologists sometimes talk about relationships in terms of the instrumental and the structural aspects, which has a tendency to be fragmenting of relationships. I'd like for you to comment on whether you think that's happening here, that this is an inherent way, sort of an implicit way in which that's creating a tension between those very important aspects of this equally important relationship.
Thank you. I'm not quite sure if I understood what you mean by fragmentation, but I think it's safe to say that the more property at stake at a particular marriage, the more carefully people planned beforehand, negotiated the two families between each other, and also they took care to go through all the proper steps of marriage. When people had less property, there was less concern because they just pooled up their chattels, and that was basically it. I would say that in Sweden, apart from landed property, which was really important, and for wealthier people, it was more pragmatic, that people just came together, and then if they separated, then the problems might actually start. So I don't know if I am actually answering your question at all, but that's how property comes into the picture here.
A round of applause for Professor Korpiola.